It should come as no surprise to anyone who understands the police state in America that those who are willing to do violence on behalf of politicians are also willing to do violence on their own behalf. And that police officers, criminals in costumes with a badge and a gun, which don't grant them any special rights, of course, are notorious in American society as sociopaths, psychopaths, violent abusers. And it's really sad to hear that people turn to them for support and protection and to deal with other criminals when they're among the most offending criminals themselves. But we've talked about how we could end the police state tomorrow if we wanted to. It would be really easy if we immediately, as a society, had the awareness of what the police state really was and decided, look, we're not going to put up with this anymore. If you're a cop, I don't want you in my life. I will not be your friend. I will not sell you groceries. I will not talk to you as a neighbor. I will not say hello or good morning. I will not sleep with you and be married to you. I will not be your boyfriend or girlfriend. I will not engage with someone who is so sick, demented, and dragging down society. But for those of you who aren't convinced by the rest of the overwhelming data on the subject, the fact that you're 8 times more likely to be killed by a cop than by a terrorist, the nature of the system and how it weeds out good cops, and the fact that there is no such thing as a good cop in America today because every single good cop is protecting the system that defends bad cops, that allows them to continue in their job. So, if you needed one more piece of data to drive this one home, if I can share with you one thing that I hope will convince you to eliminate police officers as much as practical from your life, and I mean as much as practical, no, and I know a divorce is not easy, but it's a lot more practical than getting beat every day. And I know there are people who are going to be listening to this right now who know exactly what I'm talking about. And if you're in one of these situations, not only are you doing yourself a disservice, if you're the wife of a police officer who beats you, if you're the wife or relative or girlfriend or boyfriend, or you're in some relationship with a cop who is lowering your quality of life, who is abusive to you, not only are you doing yourself a disservice to stay in that dependent, violent relationship, but you're doing the world a disservice. You're doing your community a disservice because you're telling this cop, hey, it doesn't matter what kind of asshole you are in public or in private, you're still going to get laid. You're still going to get loved. You're still going to be supported because we can't stop the paychecks from coming. As long as the United States Federal Reserve notes are forced on the American people, the government will always be able to print more and buy more people off. But we have the power to stop the people who are saying, oh, I don't care about morality. I'll do whatever the politicians say. I'll enforce whatever unjust crime laws there are as long as I'm getting my paycheck. Well, it takes a lot more than that in a society to support a police state. It takes a certain amount of social buy-in. And I think it is absolutely crucial that we do everything in our power to spread the message about the reality of the police state and disempower them. And if you want a full explanation, please see our video from Bill Buport, Badged Serial Cult Killers and the Death Cult of Politics, if you really want to understand the depth of the psychopathy of police and why there are no good police officers and why government and the police in particular are a death cult. But we hear this today from freethoughtproject.com. Cops beat their wives and girlfriends at double the national rate and still receive promotions. Yeah, so if you're thinking about dating a cop, if you're in a relationship with a cop right now, you might think, oh, well, he's so nice to me. Oh, well, yes, he treats me well. He takes me out. He's got that big fat government paycheck and he goes and buys me flowers. And I know, so he enforces the wills of, disgusting politicians, and he goes and beats up protesters and arrests people for victimless crimes. But he loves me. No, I don't think so. What are you dealing with? A psychopath who's going to be nice to you in private and then go violate people's rights in public. But do you really think that he's being nice to you in private? Because, oh, unlike everybody else in the society around him, just because you're sucking his dick, oh yeah, he's gonna be nice to you forever? No, sorry, marriage doesn't work that way. Statistics show that 1 in 4 women in the U.S. is a victim of domestic violence. Those numbers jump to 1 in 2 if they are married to a cop. Now, if you were to take cops out of the equation, that number for the general population would obviously go down a lot. And it's horrendous that it's as high as 1 in 4. But 1 in 2 if you're married to a cop, if you were to take out the cops from the general population, it might be as much as from 1 in 5 to 1 in 2. 2.5 times more likely. Law enforcement officers beat their significant other nearly double the national average. Several studies, according to Diane Wettendorf, author of Police Domestic Violence Handbook for Victims, indicate that women suffer domestic abuse in at least 40% of police officer families. Whew. For American women overall, the figure is 25%, according to the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. Now, you're probably familiar with the phenomenon of underreporting. Yeah, that's right. A lot of shit happens in America that doesn't end up in statistics. Now, do you think when a cop breaks the law and that doesn't get recorded, you think the situation is going to be any different if it's a domestic violence situation? We know, as you can take this to the bank, that when we know and we see every single day, there are stories that come out of cops engaging in misbehavior and getting caught covering it up. You know that there are tons of cases where they get away with that, where you don't hear about the abuse, where all of that just gets swept under the rug. And yet, even with the reported numbers, studies indicate, according to the Advocates for Human Rights Organization, police families are 2 to 4 times more likely than the general population to experience domestic violence, making the potential for disparities in protective success particularly troubling. Sociopaths are attracted to positions in which they are able to assert authority over others. So it should come as no surprise that there are higher concentrations of sociopaths within law enforcement. The trouble with spousal abuse lies in the very nature of police work. The authority and control in the wrong hands will be misused, according to domestic violence counselors. This isn't just somebody ranting on a soapbox. No, these are people dealing with the reality every day on the ground, domestic violence counselors. What makes police domestic violence more difficult to deal with is the fact that women feel scared to report it. Even advocates for battered women are reluctant to dive into domestic violence cases involving police for fear of alienating the agencies they rely upon for health and other abuse cases, according to a report by SF Gate. When other women report their abuse, they do so to law enforcement officers. Think about it from the position of one being abused by a law enforcement officer. The one doing the beating is simultaneously holding a position in which they are tasked with preventing that very abuse. As Diane Wettendorf says, quote, the biggest problem for a woman reporting that she's been abused by her police officer, husband, or boyfriend is that nobody believes you. There are a lot of good cops who go into work for the right reasons to help people. Then you have those who are more interested in the authority and the badge and the gun. And now I will say, there might be people that become cops for good reasons, out of naivete. But let's be honest, becoming a police officer means becoming an enemy of the people, as much as the politicians at least. And if you think that politicians are here to serve and protect you or make your life better as opposed to pay off their special interests, holy crap, start reading the news. But there is not a single good cop who makes it more than a day on the force, because in order to stay on, you have to protect the other cops. You have to defend the organization, the institutions, the policies that say, oh, well, if a cop gets caught misbehaving, their punishment is going to be, oh, I don't know, paid vacation. Yeah, they call it administrative leave while their incident is under investigation. So Diane goes on, they start out with command presence and voice to gain and maintain control, and if that doesn't work, they go up the scale with an increasing amount of force until they get compliance. Unfortunately, these guys use the same techniques with their wives and girlfriends, and some of them go from 0 to 60 right away. Really, ladies, did you expect that when you got this monster home after a wedding that all of a sudden, like, everything was just gonna, he was gonna stop this behavior, that everything was gonna be okay? That if anything, like that the accountability, the ability to get away that you had not married to him is somehow, I mean, just, you gotta be able to know who you're dealing with here, people, please. These women not only fear retaliation, but also have an apprehension about their husbands losing their jobs, thus stifling their own economic future. And I guess this leads to another layer of sickness from the wives of police officers, is that you're gonna let your husband get away with criminal behavior that hurts you, so that he can keep ripping off the taxpayers, so that he can keep abusing people's rights at the behest of politicians. If they do report it, they often run into skepticism from the same law enforcement system they are complaining to. Quote, again from Wettendorf, a big part of police culture is the code of silence. The prosecutors depend on police for their cases. The police depend on each other. It's a very insulated system. Cops often look the other way when it is one of their own facing accusations. An example of this tendency to cover up domestic police abuse can be seen in the case of Jeremy Yatchik. This monster beat and tortured his daughter for years. His girlfriend even filmed the abuse with her cell phone and brought the footage to the police department that Yatchik worked for. Now, I like to think of the case where there was the judge that was beating his daughter with a belt and she caught him on tape with that. Why do you think the guy that sentences people for victimless crimes, that has no regard for personal boundaries or personal property or your right to self-ownership, to be secure in your person, to not be beaten at home, is going to somehow respect these rights in any environment? I mean, you're talking about monsters and you're encouraging monstrous behavior. After showing the video to Glenn Johnson, the police chief, they failed to respond and she was forced to find another venue to expose this abuse. Also a study. Now, here's what gets me. This fight against the police state is often targeted at individual officers. And I understand when you have someone who has done something particularly egregious or monstrous, yes, you want them off the force, you want them off the streets, you want them behind bars and isolated from the rest of society where they can't really hurt anyone if possible. And you see people pleading to the police chiefs, to the department heads, to city council, and they do the exact same thing of excusing this bad behavior, of protecting these people. And this article even gets into that very specifically with domestic violence. But there's not, you can't just hope that the system is gonna fix itself, people. We have to actually change how we relate to cops if we wanna see any change in the system. Also, a study conducted by the Domestic Violence Task Force called Domestic Violence in the Los Angeles Police Department, How Well Does the LAPD Police Its Own?, revealed that performance evaluations of cops with history of domestic violence are largely unaffected. The study of the LAPD further examined the 91 cases in which an allegation of domestic violence was sustained against an officer. Over three-fourths of the time, this sustained allegation was not mentioned in the officer's performance evaluation. Duh, we don't care if you beat people. We, in fact, pay you to beat people. 26 of these officers, 29%, were promoted, including six who were promoted within 2 years of the incident. The report concluded that employees with sustained allegations were neither barred from moving to desired positions nor transferred out of assignments that were inconsistent with the sustained allegation. Wettendorf points out the most common fears when reporting police domestic abuse in her handbook. If your abuser is an officer of the law, you may be afraid to call the police. He is the police. Go to a shelter. He knows where the shelters are located. Have him arrested. Responding officers may invoke the code of silence. Take him to court. It's your word against that of an officer, and he knows the system. Oh, and if you think that judges are going to listen to you, you could show up in with video, apparently, beaten and bruised, and a judge will say, well, can't accept this as evidence because it contradicts the police officer's story, and we need the police to be able to lie in court and get away with it in order to keep our racket of punishing people for victimless crimes going. What do you expect? Drop the charges. You could lose any future credibility and protection. Seek a conviction. He will probably lose his job and then retaliate against you. These fears can make someone feel incredibly trapped and feel like there is no way out. And this is a much broader point about relationships. Don't be in relationships with people that are violent towards you, that don't respect your property rights, that violate your person, that beat you. I mean, holy crap, people, you can do better than this. Acceptance of bad relationships encourages bad behavior. If you or someone you know is a victim of this type of abuse, we encourage you to no longer remain silent. As long as people go unpunished, they will continue their abuse. Film it, record it, expose it in any manner you can. Tell us your story, and we will expose these abusive jackboots for the cowards they are. And I want to thank the Free Thought Project for putting that together. But really, yes, at Adam vs. the Man, we're also happy to help you expose any of these criminals if you like in your life. But or if you want to call in and talk about these issues, if you have personal experience, we definitely encourage that. But in a much broader sense, it is really easy for us. It is really easy for society to completely overthrow the police state right now. All we have to do is stop tolerating relationships with violent abusers.
Is that worth
the psychological gratification that you get from seeing a black man in the White House?
Pleased with many things from the last 3.5 years.
Do you see what my color is?